Is there a more iconic intro in all of modern rock? Not to my ears. I'm Cooper Carter here for G66, and on this week's Fractal Friday, we're dialing in Kurt Cobain's genre and era-defining sounds from Nirvana's Smells Like Teen Spirit. When Nirvana's seminal album Nevermind first took the world by storm, it heralded the arrival of a brand new era for music and for guitar playing and tone. But for as monumental and iconic as the parts and sounds on Smells Like Teen Spirit are, it's actually really a lesson in how a very simple rig paired with some classic production techniques and great part writing and playing can accomplish a whole hell of a lot. Kurt Cobain recorded the song with an early 90s Japanese Stratocaster loaded with a bridge humbucker pickup. He plugged that guitar into a Mesa Boogie Studio preamp set to its rhythm or clean channel. That fed a Crown power amp that then powered a simple Marshall 1960B 4x12 cab loaded with Celestion G12T 75 speakers. For the distorted rhythm sound, Cobain simply kicked on a Boss DS-1 distortion pedal. And for the iconic chorused parts later in the song, he simply added an Electro-Harmonix small clone chorus. To supplement this very straightforward rig, Nevermind producer Butch Vig convinced Kurt Cobain to employ a time-honored recording technique, double-tracking the guitar parts and then hard-panning them left and right. Initially, Cobain was adamant that he wasn't going to use any studio trickery on the recording, but when Butch Vig reminded him that John Lennon had himself employed double-tracking to great effect with the Beatles, Cobain relented, and you can hear double-tracking all over Nevermind. It, of course, makes the sound absolutely massive. You pair this recording technique with a masterful mix by the legendary Andy Wallace, and the result is one of the most iconic collections of guitar tones in music history. So let's dial in each of the tones from Smells Like Teen Spirit on the Axe-FX 3. Now, of course, as always, this is just a short video, but if you guys want to get the absolute most out of your Fractal Audio Systems unit, whether that's the Axe-FX 3, the FM9, or the FM3, make sure to visit classes.coopercarter.com for my complete Fractal Audio Masterclass series. So let's start off by recreating Kurt's rig here. We're going to start with an amp and a cab. Now, the exact Mesa Boogie Studio preamp that Kurt Cobain used for the Nevermind sessions is not modeled in the Fractal units, but the USA pre-clean is based on the Mesa Boogie tri-axis preamp clean channel, which is very similar, so we're going to use that as our starting point. For the cabinet, Kurt used a Marshall 1960B 412 with Celestion G12T 75 speakers. A classic cab, and if we go to the cabinet picker here and type in 1960B, hit enter, you'll see we actually have three different cabinets in the legacy bank, and in fact the 1960B T75 is this exact cabinet, the Marshall 1960B 412 with G12T 75 speakers. Very convenient there. Now, when I set out to dial in an iconic or famous sound, I really follow one of two philosophies, and every once in a while I kind of combine the two, but the first approach is to simply dial in the sound as close as possible to what I hear in my head without really referencing the original track, but starting from scratch, building the sound, and dialing it in based off what I remember, what I think I want to hear in the sound, and then at the end maybe listening to the original song, referencing it to really dial in those granular details. But starting kind of just from a reference point of my own memory of the song. So that's what I'm going to do here. The second philosophy, which we'll do a little bit later in this video, is to simply find a part of the song where the guitar is playing solo or to locate a stem track of the guitar part. There are many stems available online, on YouTube, etc. Many of them having been pulled from the Rock Band and Guitar Hero games that were very popular several years ago. And actually just tone matching with the tone match block in the Axe-FX here, that guitar part directly, which will just nail it very quickly. Sometimes that can be a great avenue. Sometimes it needs a little finessing. So I'm going to go ahead and dial it in here based off what I really kind of remember about the sound and see how close it ends up being to the actual record. So right now, starting off... Obviously, at these settings, that's a very dark tone and not really in the ballpark of what we want to get. So for anyone following along who's seen my videos before or who is a student of my masterclass, you'll know that when I'm dialing in sounds like this, I like to rely on the looper so that I don't have to play and dial in sounds at the same time. So I'm going to record this intro here with the looper. So that's sounding a lot closer, so let me check it with my actual playing. Yeah, that's sounding pretty good. Let's go ahead, though, and do a little bit of extra EQing. I'm going to throw on a parametric EQ here, and we can get just a little bit more control over the sound. I'm going to start my looper back up. You saw that I went into this output EQ here, the Mesa Boogie Studio preamp that Kurt used had a 5-band EQ, much like the Mark series of amplifiers. The Studio preamp is, in fact, very close circuit-wise to the Mark II C+. Fairly similar, not exactly the same, but much of the same circuitry. So let's start the looper back up, though, and just do a little bit more EQing here. I kind of want to peel some of the lower mids out and make a couple more granular adjustments to the high end just so that it's a little thinner, but still has the body. The tone in my head is a little less full than what I have now. So let's go ahead and start the looper back up. Yeah, that's sounding a lot closer. So again, I want to maintain the kind of body of the tone, but I wanted to carve out some of the lows and then also just kind of accentuate where some of those string mutes are really hitting, kind of up here around 3K, and then just a little more sculpting. This is, of course, based heavily on the guitar that I'm playing, which is my Ernie Ball Music Man Cutlass. I do have a humbucker in the bridge that's wound to kind of resemble a 60s humbucker, but Kurt Cobain had a Seymour Duncan in his Strat, obviously a different guitar. This EQ may be different if you have a different type of guitar and you might want to adjust it a little bit, but this is sounding pretty good. Sounds pretty good to me. So let's call that the clean. Let's switch up to our next scene here, the dirty scene. We are going to go to channel B on this PEQ. We're going to maintain the same cabinet and then, of course, the same amplifier as well. I mentioned in the intro that Kurt Cobain simply added a drive pedal, the classic Boss DS1. So let's go ahead and add that in here. And we shouldn't have to change too much. I'm just going to crank the level all the way up, the distortion all the way up, bring the tone down a little probably, and let's see what we've got there. Sounds pretty rad right out of the box, to be completely honest. But let's again do a little bit of EQ work here. I want to get some of that kind of mastered record sound in there that again comes from mostly the kind of post work that somebody like Andy Wallace or Butch Vig would have been doing to the guitars on the board itself. So we're just going to push and pull a little bit like we did before. So that's sounding pretty aggressive. It's got nice sizzle on top. Let's move up to our third scene now. We're going to make this our clean chorus. So we're going to need to replace this looper here that we're all done with a chorus pedal. Now, again, Kurt Cobain used a small clone chorus. I'm going to probably go with the analog mono here. And we're going to bring the rate up. The rate on this chorus is about where the tempo is. It's not exact because obviously, you know, they didn't set it on that pedal to an exact BPM, but somewhere up around 4. Yeah, and then I wanna jack that depth way up. Well, maybe not that high up, but. Make sure we're on the right PEQ here. Yeah, the clean. So that sounds pretty good. And then we'll go up to this next scene. We're gonna call this the dirty chorus. We've got the chorus on, we've got our drive on, we've got our amp. We've got the cab that's on A. We want it on that same cab. And we want our PEQ on our dirty PEQ. And so now this is for the... for the pre-chorus, of course. And then lastly, we want to dial in our lead sound. So the lead in this song, to me, seems heavier than what this pedal that's already dimed on 10 on the level and the distortion and this clean amp can bring. And I don't know for sure if Kurt Cobain switched over to the more distorted channel on his studio pre to record the lead. But what I want to do is just hop up to channel B here, and I'm going to select the USA pre lead one, which is just the dirtier lead channel on the Triaxis amp. And I'm going to just dial in a more distorted kind of sound for this lead. Again, I don't know for a fact that he switched up to that. He may have used a different drive pedal or another drive pedal on top of the DS1. Not sure, but I just want a little more girth, a little more ballsy sound here for the lead. So let's dial in something here. I'm going to turn off this chorus for a second. All right, so we've got a much ballsier sound there. And then the last thing I want to add for this lead, not only does it sound like the lead is double tracked, just like the rhythm guitars, but there's also a good bit of room on it. And I'm not sure if that was a room mic in the actual studio or if it was an outboard reverb that was brought in post. But let's go ahead and add a reverb block here. I'm going to go with the small room reverb type. And we're just going to get basically like a little bit of ambience here. We don't want it to be too much of an effect, but it's going to be just enough to kind of suggest some reverb. Let's see how that sounds. It's already kind of getting there. Let's bring this down just a little bit. I'm going to bring the size up just to get those reflections a little further away. Sounding better, and let's bring this mix up. Sweet. All right, cool. So now we have all five of our sounds for Smells Like Teen Spirit. But of course, so much of the sound of these guitar parts is the double tracking. So let's add a little something to help it sound like this is double tracked if you are going to use this preset playing alone, which of course you would be if you were doing it live in the studio. You can always record two tracks and hard pan them. What I'm going to do is go to the Petrucci rig preset, and we have this pitch block here that I designed to mimic the Mimic pedal from TC Electronics, which is one of the better pedals for kind of simulating double tracking live. I have another video on how I actually built this pedal. There's some modifier work going on in controllers that are moving the values around to simulate a more natural kind of double tracking. I'm gonna go and just copy this into our Teen Spirit preset. So we don't want it on in our clean because that's the beginning of the song and it's not double tracked, but we do want it on for our dirty, for our clean chorus, for our dirty chorus, and for our lead. So let's hear what that sounds like if I go from this clean that is quote single tracked up to a double tracked rhythm. So a much wider, much more expansive sound. So here is this dirty channel without the pitch on. And here it is with it. A really nice facsimile of double tracking. I would be thrilled to cover this song with these sounds live, or maybe record my own version of it, or jam to a backing track with these sounds. But if we really want to get the exact album sound, there's a very quick process that many of you may be familiar with, and we can actually tone match the stems. So I actually have the Smells Like Teen Spirit stems here. The clean part, of course, is already soloed at the very beginning of the song. but you can get on the internet, you can pull them up on YouTube and tone match from there, the complete solo guitar without any drums or bass or vocals. So we have the rhythm, and then here's the lead. There's a good amount more room in there, like we dialed in on that lead. So what I'm going to do is go to our preset here. I'm going to bypass our parametric EQ. I'm going to bypass our cabinet block. Just going to move the pitch and the reverb over, and I'm going to add a tone match block. Now, this is only available on the AXFX 3, but what I'm going to do is after I make these tone matches, I'm going to export them as IRs, and I'm going to put them into a cabinet block so that anyone using either the AXFX 3, the FM9, or the FM3 can use this preset on their unit. So the first thing we want to do is make sure the tone match block is set up to tone match correctly. We want to set our reference source as USB 1 and 2. I'm using the AXFX 3 as my sound device in Reaper, where I'm playing this stem. If you were using YouTube, you would also want to select USB 1 and 2 and make sure that your AXFX is your sound device for your computer. The reference channel we want is just the left. We don't want a sum because that can introduce phase cancellation and mess up the tone match. We're just going to use the left side. The local channel, we're also going to select left. And then for mode, we don't want live. That's for matching an actual physical real-world amplifier. We want offline. I'm going to set my averaging time to 10 seconds because I find that creates a little bit smoother of a curve over the course of time when you're playing in a stem. And now we are almost ready to go. I'm going to go to capture here. And what I want to do is create a little loop here. I'm going to go into Reaper, and I'm just going to loop this clean sound right here. And I want to then play on my guitar more or less the same part. Now, this is a fairly straightforward part, so that's going to be pretty easy. But you just want to play along to it. And we're just going to play along for 20 seconds or so. So let's go ahead and start our loop here. And I'm going to start our tone match. You can see here the resulting tone match curve. And now I'm going to export our tone match to a cabinet IR. I'm going to call it Teen Spirit Clean. We'll export it to cabinet slot 1. Now we'll tell our cabinet block to select that cabinet. So we have our tone match now loaded in to our clean. Let's go ahead and switch up to our dirty channel here. We're going to, again, bypass our PEQ, bypass the cabinet, and we're going to run another tone match. So let's go ahead and cue up the loop for our dirty sound. Let's just go ahead and loop this rhythm part right here. I'll go ahead and start that, and we're going to play along and match it. Here's our resulting tone match. And now I'm going to export that resulting tone match to an IR as well. We'll call that Teen Spirit Dirty. We're going to save it in number 2. Now we can go to our cabinet block and go up to channel B and slot in our dirty tone match. Now let's jump up to our lead scene. We're going to, again, bypass the cabinet, bypass the PEQ. I'm going to go over to Reaper, and let's loop this lead section here. I'm going to play along, start both my reference and my local, and then match. And now let's export this tone match as Teen Spirit Lead to user cab slot number 3. And now we are all done with our tone match block. So I'm going to shunt that. We are done with our PEQ. So I'm going to shunt that. And we can select channel C on our cabinet, user cab number 3. At the link in this video's description, you can download this final cleaned up preset. And again, because the tone matches were exported as cabinet IRs and have been placed into this cabinet block, this preset is fully usable across the line of Fractal Audio products, the FM3, the XFX3, the FM9, whichever unit you have. I'm going to export this preset as a preset and cabinet bundle so that the preset and the 3 IRs that you need are bundled in one file. If you need guidance on how to import and install a preset cabinet bundle, there is an existing video that can help you out with that. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please do make sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to G66's channel, and leave me a comment in the comment section below letting me know what you would like to see on a future episode of Fractal Friday. There are some very special tone tours coming in the next couple weeks from some of Fractal's larger artists, many of which are artists that you guys have requested in the comments in past Fractal Fridays. So do look forward to that coming very soon. And as always, if you guys want to get the absolute most out of your Fractal Audio Systems unit, whether that's the AXFX3, the FM9, or the FM3, make sure to visit classes.coopercarter.com for my complete Fractal Audio Masterclass series. For all things Fractal Audio, keep it right here on G66, and I will see you very soon on Fractal Friday.